How many of you have been practicing for 6 months or less? Please. 6 months or less than 6 months? Okay. Thank you. So, what I'd like to say tonight is mainly aimed at you, and of course all of us. If you've been practicing longer than 6 months or a year or 2 years, you probably are familiar with what I would like to explain. That is that when we first begin to practice, it may seem like a very big deal, a very big problem, very big difficulty. It feels like the effort that we are being asked to make, to practice, to come and sit, is too big. It might feel like it's too much addition, too much to include in our life. We may feel that the time required to practice interferes with our daily life. We don't have time. Oh, the practice impacts my family, or it's just uncomfortable. A number of things can come up when we first start to practice. It makes it appear to be a big hurdle. But if you have a deep desire, a deep concern to understand your life, if you have a desire to appreciate your life, and if you want to live naturally and completely, then practice is no problem. Despite some inconveniences, practice is no problem. Now, the Buddha, he was very pragmatic about his practice. There was no magic to what he was doing or trying to do or trying to understand. There was no mystery in his mind. He wanted to practice so that he would understand how to live his life according to the truth of things. Now, in Zen mind, beginner's mind, Suzuki Roshi says this: a Buddha was not interested in metaphysical theories of existence. He was more concerned with how he himself existed in this moment. How we become enlightened was his main interest. He wanted to find out how human beings develop ideal character, how sages in the past became sages. So, almost like a scientist, very practical, very pragmatic. He wanted to explore his life, and he wanted to have a complete life. Our practice, the unique aspect of Zen practice is that it is based on what's going on now, right now. And so the teaching tells us that keeping our mind on the present is how we become Buddha, how we express our true nature. Which means we are trying to let go of the extraneous busyness of the activity of our small mind so that we can express Buddha's activity. In other words, we, in our practice, we want to learn how to stay open to our mind's activity just as it appears. We want to be aware of how the mind is doing, how Buddha is doing. So the fundamental nature of our practice is to come back to our breath, moment by moment. And when we keep our mind on this very simple activity, it means we are keeping our mind on the present moment. But that can be a challenge, as you know. If you have been sitting for a few minutes, a few hours, 6 months or more, keeping your mind in the present moment can be a challenge, and you know that. Because it is impossible to keep our mind on the present moment 100% of the time. It's just not possible. The mind is always wandering, always looking for something. The mind cannot get rid of its desires. It's just the nature of being human. It's the nature of being alive. We are always looking for something outside of ourselves, like a curious kitten, always exploring, always reaching out. And because desires are always arising in our mind is at risk for becoming attached to something. This is the activity of our small mind. We call it small mind. But it doesn't have to be a problem. Because when we understand this aspect of ourselves, we simply just accept it, and we don't try to fight it. We just accept it, that that's the way it is when we are human. So we don't need to feel upset or to feel sorry that our mind wanders now and then, or that we have desires and become attached to things and people now and then. It's part of being human. But at the same time, we should make our effort to stay present, stay in the present moment. And this bringing the mind back to the present is not a form of discipline. It is simply Buddha's activity. At first, the effort to bring our mind back to the present, back to our breath, bring our awareness into the present moment, at first it does seem like some kind of mental exercise. But with practice, it becomes very natural and no longer feels like a big effort. It becomes natural. And we simply continue this activity. And there we discover the sage. We discover who Buddha was looking for. So there's a famous saying in our practice that to study Buddhism is to study the self. And this study is not an analytical or an intellectual study of ourself. We are not an observer outside of ourself, studying ourself. What this statement means is that we experience ourself in the midst of our activity. Not from outside, but from intimately associated with our activity, we experience ourself. And we learn how to do this through zazen practice. Well, everyone, we all have difficulties in life. There's no escaping difficulties in life. But even so, even with difficulties, we do not give up our effort. We do not give up our practice. We do not give our practice so that we can discover how to develop character. We don't give up. And this not giving up is the spirit and the secret of our practice. Not giving up. Because if we do give up our effort when we feel it is difficult or their life is difficult, if we do give up our effort, we will never go beyond the small mind and we will always be driven by desire. So actually, it's foolish to give up our effort for any reason. On the other hand, continuing our effort is how we can give up foolishness. How we can see the nature of our foolishness. And when we see, when we recognize that we are thinking, oh, I can't make the effort because life is difficult. When we see ourselves thinking that, we understand how we magnify our difficulties. This is seeing the self. This is seeing how we turn difficulties into suffering. So if we want to end suffering, and if we want to learn how to truly take care of difficulties that arise, we have to make an effort. We have to make an effort to continue our practice, so that we can understand how it is that the mind fools itself. And this is a very important point. The Buddha's teachings, all the writings about what Buddha said and all the commentaries about what Buddha said. The Buddhist teachings emphasize Buddha's wisdom. Buddha's wisdom. His wisdom about how suffering occurs. And about how we ourselves create suffering again and again. Buddha's teachings are about that. How we continue to create karma through our self-oriented thinking. Through our self-oriented thinking. And his teachings include how we can end our suffering and our karma. But actually, despite everything that's written, all the written recordings of what Buddha said, or what he was supposed to have said, and all the commentaries about what Buddha said, the biggest teaching is the story of Buddha's effort, his effort. Because it is through our effort. Our effort is the foundation of how we end confusion. It is through our effort that we discover the natural way of life. So, to continue our effort and to make as big an effort as possible is far more important than mastering all the written words about what Buddha said. It is our effort that is the most important point in our practice. The unique feature of Buddhist teachings. The teaching of Buddhism that makes Buddhism unique from all other religious teachings is that everyone is already Buddha. Buddha is not external, Buddha is not outside. Everyone is already Buddha. This is the foundation of Buddhist teaching and Buddhist practice. Everyone is already Buddha, even though our human tendencies persist and habits and desires arise. Everyone is already Buddha. This is important teaching. If we can recognize and acknowledge our foolishness and make our effort in the midst of foolishness, there is Buddha. There is the sage. So Buddha recognized how weak human nature can be. Our human nature that can be easily distracted by desires, by cravings, by acquisitions, by guarding our possessions. And a number of sutras talk about this point, how foolish we are. So Buddha preached giving up possessions as a way to guard the mind from attachments and suffering. Give up your possessions. And he preached about things to avoid, and he preached about places to avoid, and he encouraged the monastic life. And Dogen, our founder, preached doing the same thing as a way to avoid temptations. But 21st century, 20th and 21st century. For most people, it's not possible to disengage from society. Very few people can lead a reclusive life in order to avoid attachments. That sort of life is not appropriate for the majority of us in the modern world. We cannot follow that part of Buddha's teaching. It's okay for a short time. It's actually very good for a short time. It can help you see what it is that you can truly live without. And there are opportunities to disengage from everyday society for a short period. It's possible. And we can learn a lot. But we have to return to the world of people and things and jobs and family and commuting and paying the bills and all those things. We have to return. So we have to live in the world of temptations. The world of material things and the world of emotional things. We have to live in that world and learn how not to be seduced by them. we have to live there with those things and learn how to have Buddha's mind. This is the challenge. This is the challenge of our practice. This is the challenge our practice presents to us. And so we come here to practice because we believe, because we trust that even though we live in the everyday world of temptations, we can discover Buddha's way, and we can live Buddha's way. It can be difficult, it can be challenging, but there is no question that we can do it. After you have been practicing for a little while, you will have the same confidence that Buddha had, that it is within everybody's capacity to do it. So our continuous effort is the key to discovering the sage that Suzuki Roshi spoke about.